Ionic compounds can get a little more complicated than simple binary compounds. We looked at binary compounds in a previous video. In this video, we want to look at how to name ionic compounds when polyatomic ions are present. You can Google polyatomic ions. You can find lots and lots and lots of tables of polyatomic ions. These are ions that exist as a group rather than just a single atom, a group of atoms. That group of atoms has a particular charge. For example, here on the top we see the sulfate ion, and its symbol is SO subscript 4, and everything has a negative 2 charge. This is a table that is taken from a handout if you're in my class. We have this handout available to us at our class site. It's called the Nomenclature Handout. And this is not a complete list of polyatomic ions, but these are some of the most common. If you look through them, you can see some trends and you can see some patterns, but the bottom line is you have to memorize these. You have to learn them. You have to be familiar with them. So let's go back to our screen and we'll work on nomenclature, ionic compounds with polyatomic ions. For example, if you've got your periodic table handy, take a look. If we look at, for example, the calcium ion, calcium is a plus 2 charge. If the calcium ion combines with a polyatomic ion, for example, let's say it combines with the nitrate ion, NO3 with a negative 1 charge, then the name of this compound, I can name it just knowing that it's made up of these two ions by simply naming those two ions. The name of the compound that is made up of these two ions is called calcium nitrate. Don't make it any harder than that. When you name an ionic compound, you simply name the two ions that make it up. Now, writing the formula of calcium nitrate means combining the ions such that their charges match. The plus charge matches the negative charge. And we saw that in a previous video. The thing that is different here is that I now have not a binary compound. It's not a single element with a negative charge. It's a group of elements, in this case nitrogen and 3 oxygen, which altogether has the negative 1 charge. So I have to treat it like a group. The calcium has a plus 2 charge. I would need 2 of these groups, 2 nitrate ions, in order to get a negative 2 charge to balance. And so my formula would be CaNO3, and then to indicate there are 2 of these, I can't just stick a 2 here. That looks like 32 oxygens. I need parentheses. So it's Ca parentheses NO3 with a subscript 2. And this formula literally means I have these 3 ions in my compound. And the name is again calcium nitrate. You don't have to indicate that there are 2 nitrate ions because that's taken care of by knowing the charges. How did I know this was the nitrate ion? If I don't have it memorized, I go look it up. You must simply be familiar with that list and familiar with the names enough to go look them up. All right, let's do another one. If you are given the name iron Roman numeral 2 phosphate, all right, and you're told to write the formula for that compound, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to recognize, well, it's an ionic compound because iron is a metal. Ionic compounds are made up of metals and nonmetals, with very few exceptions. And so any compound that begins with an iron, for us in general chemistry, that's going to be an ionic compound, which means I immediately need to start thinking about the ions. This is the iron Roman numeral 2 ion. These are the ions that make it up, and this is the phosphate ion. This is how it works. This is how naming ionic compounds works. The name of the ionic compound is simply the name of the two ions. Drop off the word ions and put them together. That's the way it works. So now I have to draw the symbols for these two ions. Iron Roman numeral 2, let's bring it down. All right, iron Roman numeral 2, iron is Fe, you should have that memorized by now. The Roman numeral 2 means that it is a plus 2 charge. You might see it as a plus 2 or a 2 plus, you can see it both ways. because I'm not picky about how you write it. If you run into an instructor who is picky, you want to do it the way that your instructor tells you to. All right, the phosphate ion I'm going to recognize is a polyatomic ion. This is how I know. I have memorized something called the phosphide ion, which is just the phosphorus atom with his negative 3 charge because of where he is in the periodic table. The phosphide ion is the monatomic, one atom only phosphorus with his negative charge. The phosphate ion is something different. Anytime you see these 8 endings, that's a good indication you've got a polyatomic, although that's not the only ending that we see. So I'm going to go look it up if I don't have it memorized, and what I'll find is that the phosphate ion is PO4 with a negative 3 charge. Be very careful when you write this. It is a capital O. If you write P little O4, that's 4 polonium atoms. Capital versus lowercase make a difference in our atoms, in writing the symbols for atoms, and so you want to be very careful. So this is not correct. Let's get rid of it. All right. So here I have my two ions. These are the two ions that make up iron, Roman numeral 2, phosphate, and now all I have left to do is to put them together such that their charges balance. This is kind of like a least common multiples exercise. I've got a plus 2 and a minus 3. That means I'll need 3 of these and 2 of these in order to balance those charges. And so I'll have Fe3, PO4. Again, I can't just drop a 2 subscript here. I need parentheses. And now I have I've balanced the ionic charges. This is iron, Roman numeral 2. Notice there are 3 of them. This 3 does not coincide with that Roman numeral 2, and it's not supposed to. That's not what this 3 means. This not what this Roman numeral 2 means. This Roman numeral 2 is the charge on the iron ion. The fact that there are 3 of them is in order to balance with the phosphate ion, which I went and looked up if I didn't have memorized.